Hi there. Welcome to my home for my weekly Facebook Live. I hope you caught my Facebook Live from a couple of days ago, which I did with together with JP Sears. He is hilarious, but he's not only funny, but he's also sensitive and a genuinely nice guy. So I had a lot of fun chatting with him. And if you didn't get a chance to watch it live, it doesn't matter. The video is on Facebook, and it either already is on my YouTube channel or will be on my YouTube channel. Please check it out. So today, I wanted to talk about the healing power of transformation. And let me give you a little more detail about what that's going to be about. But also, what I'd love is if in the comments, if there's any issues with this video, like technical issues, if you can't hear me, you can't see me, or anything like that, let me know, because the only way for me to know that this is going out loud and clear and that everything technically is working correct is by your comments. And Danny is behind the scenes. I couldn't do this without him, and he's reading your comments, and this is the only way we know when you tell me that, oh my God, I can't hear you, or I can't see the video, or whatever. So let me know, and we will fix it as we go along. So the topic I've chosen, actually, it includes people who, it is for people who are dealing with physical challenges and who have a fear of illnesses. And the topic, the reason I'm choosing it, is inspired by the requests we get. Okay, we've got feedback. Technically, everything is fine here in Iceland. Sound is fantastic. Thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you for tuning in from Iceland. Wow, that's fabulous. All good technically. Kira. Thank you. So the reason for this, for what I'm about to talk about today, is the amount of letters I get and requests I get from many of you that say how to deal with the fear of cancer recurring when you've had it before. So when you've had cancer before, and then you are now cancer-free, but there is a fear that it is going to reoccur. And this is a common fear. It's a very common fear that if you've dealt with it before, but also people who've never had cancer also fear getting it. I mean, that's the position I was in before I even had cancer. And a big reason for this fear is because we are in a paradigm that focuses on cancer. It doesn't focus on the reason why healthy people are healthy. It focuses on cancer and how not to get cancer. And the more you focus on how not to get something, that thing becomes an issue. When you stop focusing on that thing altogether and you get on with life, that thing is no longer an issue. And this is the case with everything. The more we focus on our ego, the more the ego is an issue. The more you forget about the ego and you don't even think about it, it stops being an issue. The more you focus on money and how to get money, the more money becomes an issue. But the more you don't think about money, but you focus on following your passion, doing what you love, and so on, and finding your freedom, the money comes and it stops being an issue. The more you don't allow money to be an issue, it stops being an issue. And this is the same with health. The more you focus on health, even if you believe that what you're focusing on is health, I'm focusing on health and well-being, I'm trying to be healthy here, what actually happens is health becomes an issue because you're focused on it. And I hope what I'm saying, I'm clear, or what I'm saying is resonating or making sense with you, because this is what happened to me even before I had cancer the first time. So I had this incredible fear of cancer, like huge fear of cancer. I was watching two people my age, close to me, go through cancer. And they were going through treatments. They were going through the whole thing, like the chemo, the radiation, everything. And I didn't see them getting better. So I feared cancer. I feared the treatment of cancer. and I feared death. And so I wanted to do everything I could to avoid cancer. So to me, cancer became the issue that I focused on. So everything I did was driven from a place of not wanting cancer. So I started to research more on cancer and how to avoid cancer. I started to purchase all the supplements that were antioxidants, anti-cancer, and I started to take all these supplements, boatloads, every day. I started to follow an anti-cancer diet. The problem with anti-cancer diets is that every couple of weeks, as you continue to research, information changes, and you can read one thing that'll contradict another. And there I was, like, eating organic. I cut out everything that I would read that would cause cancer. And I was making, I was juicing every day. I was having wheatgrass shots. I was eating organic, and I wasn't drinking, and I wasn't taking any sugar. And I would make sure I was taking my boatload of supplements. And I was determined that I was not going to get cancer because I was so vigilant and I was fighting against having cancer. And you know what happened? I got cancer. So here's the thing. What I realized, and I didn't even realize this from having cancer, I realized this from dying from cancer, that the focus is supposed to be on living life, on being passionate about life. And I think I just saw a comment from someone who said, Rosemary, I have had cancer and tried to stay away from sorry groups, which reminded me of my past disease. Yes, so I too, and I like that comment, because when I was diagnosed, I joined one of these cancer support groups. And when I joined, I realized I didn't want to be part of that group because I didn't want to spend all my time being reminded that I have cancer and I want to deal with cancer. But everything, every kind of support, everything to help me through my journey was taking me back to being that person who has cancer, who is scared of cancer. And so this is why my suggestion to you, if you are dealing with it, if you have dealt with cancer and you no longer have it, your focus is not about how do I stop being afraid of cancer or how do I deal with cancer. It's about how do I live life? What is my passion? That is where your focus needs to be. And that is what I'm here to tell you. And this is why people often say to me, like constantly, they say to me, why aren't you advocating the right way to eat and diets? And that's so important. And people are always telling me that. So there's several reasons I don't go on about diets and things like that. It's because one man's poison is another man's medicine. And that's something I discovered, that things that were advocated to me as being anti-cancer was terrible for me because it made me weaker because I missed the foods that were the comfort foods for me. So you have to listen to your own body. You really do. One size does not fit all. So that's one reason I don't advocate what you need to eat to deal with illness to be well. I just don't do that because then it becomes dogma. And dogma means you're doing it from a place of fear. You're doing it because you're scared of getting cancer, and that's why you're going to follow this whatever, this diet. Or this. That's not the reason to do it. That's not a good way to live. I advocate living from a place of love and passion because the biggest determining factor of your health is your passion for life. That is the number one thing. And if you have a passion for certain foods, go for it. And if you have a passion for life, you will listen to your body. If your body says eat greens, you'll eat greens. And you will eat greens, you will get healthy. If your body says I need these particular supplements, eat these particular supplements. But your body will also tell you, I don't need those supplements. Or it'll tell you, I don't need to juice every single day. I can do it once a week, twice a week. But today, I feel like eating cheesecake. And my body is strong enough to handle it. That's the thing. It's about what works for you as an individual. It's about finding your passion as an individual. And so so here's the other thing, piece I want to say, which is really important and probably provocative, and it's something which I get called on by people in the medical community, but I'm going to say it anyway. And when I say called on, because it is so outside the scope of science and medicine, cancer is not in your physical body, it's in your consciousness. Are you there? I said it. It's not in your physical body, it's in your consciousness. I said it again. So let me tell you where I'm going with this. When it's embedded in your consciousness, that I am afraid of cancer, or I am going to have cancer, it's in my DNA because my mother had it, my aunt had it, blah, blah, blah. You are living the life of a cancer personality, of somebody who is extremely aware of cancer. Now, when people do these studies and they say, oh, people in Okinawa, which is an island off of Japan, their rate of cancer is at the lowest, and this is the diet they follow. And they bring this diet to the West, and they say, this is the diet to follow because their rate of cancer is lower. Here's the problem. You are following that diet from a cancer consciousness. You're following that diet in order to avoid cancer. When the people in Okinawa are following their diet, they're not even thinking about cancer. It's not even in their consciousness. Do you get what I mean by this? They're following that diet because that's their diet. And the reason they live longer and the reason they're healthier is because they're not even thinking about cancer. It's because they're too busy living their life. That's what I mean. And so it's about getting cancer out of your consciousness, even while you are dealing with it. So I'm not telling you stop your treatments. If you're having treatments, or, you know, I'm not a doctor, I'm not going to stop you from having your treatments. But the point is, follow treatments that help you to get to this place where you can get cancer out of your consciousness. That is what I really want to invite you to do. And thank you. Oh my God. Thank you all of you for what you're saying. I know that so many of you resonate with this. I know there are a lot of people that are afraid to say this because you do get attacked by the medical community or by debunkers or people who are steeped in pharmaceuticals and medicine and so on, because the cancer research industry only looks at the physical. They only look at medicine. They only research earlier and earlier detection technology, but they don't look at how cancer manifests as the kind of people and what we're feeling emotionally. And I'm going to get a little bit more tangible soon to give you some real tangible things that you can do. But I just wanted to share a little bit more. Anya Thaibo, thank you for your comment. Wow, so profound. Thank you. So what I realized was, even after I healed from the cancer, knowing everything I knew that the cancer had been in my consciousness, that it was from the fear. And I knew I now had to focus on living life. And this is what I invite you to do. If you have had cancer, but what the people around you, the medical system that we live in, and even to an extent, even the natural healing system we have, is that there is this feeling that, okay, I had cancer, I want to prevent it. Because if you notice that even when people talk about health, they talk about cancer prevention. Cancer prevention is better than cancer curing. The thing is, what I'm talking about is, let's not even focus on cancer altogether and let's focus on living life. That's where I was when I came back. But I noticed that normally, and this is why I want to say this, is it took death for me to realize this. And this is why I want to say this to you, because when you go through the normal treatment system and are made to feel that the treatments is what helped you to manage the cancer, and now you are in remission for 5 years, the tendency is, okay, how do I prevent cancer from coming back? And then everything you do is motivated from a place of preventing cancer from coming back. And this is the shift I want you to make. It's not about preventing cancer from coming back. It's about how does a well person live life? The reason I got cancer in the first place was because I was not living life as a well person. I was living life as a person who feared cancer. That is my point. So let me go into the into the bullet points that of the questions I want you to ask yourself. Number one, the question I want you to ask yourself, if you have had cancer and you are now cancer-free, I want you to ask yourself, what shall I do with the rest of my life now as a healthy person? Remember, you have to think in terms of, I am done with cancer. I'm done with cancer. Doctors may have said I'm in remission, but to me, remission means it's time for me to remember my mission. So what am I going to do with the rest of my life as a healthy person? And then the number two, this is a really important question. And yes, Michelle Lerner-Myers, it's about getting it out of your mind. It's about getting it out of your consciousness. It's out of your body now, but if you keep focusing on it, you're keeping it in your consciousness. So it's about getting it out of your consciousness. So it's like, so the question is, now that I am cancer-free, what am I going to do with the rest of my life as a healthy person? So don't even think in terms of being cancer-free. It's, I am a healthy person. What am I going to do now with the rest of my life as a healthy person? Because you weren't living as a healthy person before. That's why you got cancer. You see, now you need to live as someone who doesn't even have to worry about illness of any kind. Number two, This is something a lot of people have trouble doing, but you're going to do it. You're going to use your imagination and you're going to do it. Because remember, there are no guarantees in life, but this is what you're going to do. If I was guaranteed that I was never going to get cancer or sick or run over by a bus, if I was guaranteed those things, what would I be doing with the rest of my life? How would I live my life? If I was guaranteed that nothing bad was going to happen to me, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? And that's how I would like you to think of your life. I want you to live it that way, as if you are guaranteed that you're never going to get sick and you're never going to get sick again. Live it that way. The third thing, and this is important, is that you have to keep your focus on living life and not on avoiding sickness. So every time you see that fear creeping in, that, oh my gosh, the cancer might come back, I've got this pain over here. And I want you to switch that focus around and say, oh, my body is actually my body is actually my friend. My body is smarter than I give it credit for. My body is just telling me that, oh, it just needs to be more supported in whatever. I need to maybe eat a little bit healthier this week. I need to have more kale this week, or I need to juice more this week. And also maybe I need to find my passion. I need to go and do something that makes me happy. I need to call on my friends and laugh a little bit more. Your body could be telling you any number of things. Your body is not telling you that I have cancer, because in actuality, cancer is a culmination of you not listening to your body for a prolonged period of time. Your body is not telling you, be scared. It never tells you that. It is actually telling you what you need to do to heal. Your body is always, always, always your friend. Always. Your body is always giving you signals on how to heal. So that's number three, is when you listen to your body, remember, your body is helping you. Your body is always telling you how to heal. Always. Medical people go by statistics of what they're seeing. And remember that a lot of the people, they mean well, doctors mean well, but doctors are really fearful because they see a lot. But all those people they see are not you. They don't know you. They don't know that you have the zest and passion for life and that you're going to use this as a springboard to take you to the next level. They don't know this. They're dealing with people who have no reason to live, who are looking for a way out. They're dealing with people whose lives are so messed up, you know, and we need to help those people too. Sure, of course we do. But we need to help them by awakening them to the fact that their life is messed up. And medicine is not going to heal that life which is causing the cancer. The cancer is just a symptom. The physical illness is just a symptom. So when your body gives you a physical ailment, that is a signal for a symptom for something for you to heal. Now, here's the other thing I want to tell you is that, so number four is that you don't need to figure out what it is that's causing that symptom. That causes us a downward spiral. So when you're trying to think, oh my God, what am I doing that's causing the cancer? That puts you back in fear of all the things you're doing. No, don't figure out what's causing the symptom. What I want you to do is go and do something as a well person. What would a well person do now? In my head, what does a healthy person look like? So I want to repeat this number four again. Don't try and figure out what is causing the illness or the cancer. No. Ask yourself, what does a well and healthy and passionate person look like to me? What does their life look like? What are they doing? And go and do that. That feels so much better and will take you right out of fear. But trying to figure out what it is that's causing the symptoms so you can stop doing it, that will take you down the spiral of, oh my God, you know, like, what is it I'm doing? What am I doing wrong? What can I change? What can I heal? Okay, so let me say those again. Number one is to tell yourself, I am now cancer-free. What shall I do now with the rest of my life? Number two is, if I was guaranteed never to get cancer again or never to get any illness or anything, if that was guaranteed, how would I shape my life? What would my life look like? And I want you to start doing that. Number three is focus on living life and don't even focus on the illness. Try and get it out of your consciousness. I shouldn't even be talking about it right now, but here I am. I need to just to help you through this. And number four was about not even trying, don't even figure out what it is that caused it. Don't even go down that road of saying, oh my gosh, what was I doing before that caused it? Nope. Just ask yourself, what does a healthy person look like to me? What does a person who's following their passion look like for me? What does following my dreams mean for me? And go and do those things. That's number four. Number five is don't hesitate to get help, but the kind of help that supports you and not makes you feel fearful. So when I was getting help, when I was sick, my problem was I had a lot of people around me who made me feel fearful about what was happening. So many of the things I did from a place of fear. And when I was doing these from a place of fear, the cancer was getting worse. So what I want you to do is choose whatever heals you that feels like it supports you. Thank you, Radhika. Radhika says, I'm a physician. I totally resonate with this. Thank you. Disease shows up in our mind space prior to manifesting in the physical body. Joe Dispenza's healing method is the same. Yes, he is. And I totally strongly advocate and believe in what Joe Dispenza does and Bruce Lipton. Those guys, and also, of course, Greg Braden. Those guys are absolutely amazing and spot on. And I am so happy when physicians and doctors tune into this kind of thing, tune into what we're saying, because this is really the way to go. The true healing of cancer does not lie in drugs. It does not lie in technology for earlier and earlier detection of cancer. It truly lies in eradicating it from our consciousness and focusing on living life. Because when cancer is not the problem. Cancer is the result of a problem already being there. And you don't need to figure out what that problem is. You need to just focus on what an ideal solution looks like for you. Like, what does my life look like as a healthy and healed person? So even me, even where I am right now, I'm not deal with cancer. In my normal life, everyday life, I don't even think about it. When I eat foods, when I make decisions, when I take supplements, it's got nothing to do with cancer, even though I had cancer. In the past, when I used to go and see doctors, healers, their baseline was always, oh, you've had terminal cancer before, so you need to do this, this, this to support yourself. I'm like, no, I am a well person and I'm going to live like a well person. And that's how I've been living. And here I am today, 12 years later, still here. I plan to be here for a very long time. But it doesn't mean that I don't take care of my well-being, because I want to live long. I'm passionate about my life, and I surround myself with people who can support me on that journey. And so I do enlist the help of other experts. So it doesn't mean, so when I tell people, don't give your power away, don't buy into fear-based tactics, don't do things from a place of fear, but it doesn't mean you don't need expert help. And the reason why I say go for expert help is because then you feel supported. You can relax. It doesn't mean going it on your own, because even when you go it on your own, you can get into fear when you're out of your area of expertise when dealing with something. You might be dealing with, like Danny's dealing with sciatica pain, or you might be dealing with something that's beyond your scope. But go for help with people who have the expertise, but who will support you and take you from where you are now to optimum health. And to take you to optimum health for you, where you feel you're actually being supported, understood, and somebody who will not fear you, who will not make you feel fear through the use of statistics. Shivani Gakkar, thank you. Drugs buy you time till you figure out how to live your life better. Yes, exactly. So if you do use medicine, if you do use drugs, think of them as buying you time while you live your life of passion. And I tend to prefer not to go back and dig around as to how did I get here, what did I do wrong. I tend to think, okay, what do I do to get over this hump? What do I do to live my life as a well person? Because that makes me feel much, much more uplifted in this whole thing. So get the help you need. That was number 5. And number 6 is to surround yourself with people who support you. So, see, the thing is, what happened is that when I discovered what it was that was causing me to be sick, I realized that in order to be a well person, I would almost have to be a completely different person. But when I say a different person, I would have to be true to myself. I would have to be who I truly am, my authentic self. I realized that the person who I had been up until the point I got sick was not the real me. And it wasn't even the cancer that made me realize this. It literally was death. And I don't want people to have to realize this at death. I want you to realize this before you even get sick. I realized that I was a people pleaser. I always worried about other people more than me. I always worried about what other people thought of me. I was afraid of disappointing people. I was a doormat. I was non-confrontational. I avoided conflict. All these things to my detriment. And I'm not judging anyone who's like that, because I was like that. But the thing is, that led to my own demise, this is why I tell people, love yourself like your life depends on it, because it does. Because you can be there for everyone and become so drained and never fill your own heart or the own hole within yourself to the point where you get sick. And even when I was sick, I didn't take care of myself. I still always worried about other people and making sure other people were okay. And I didn't want to be around other people when I needed to charge my batteries, because I felt that my tendency was to always care for other people. So it was very draining to even have people care for me, because I would feel obligated to them if they cared for me. I didn't want people to actually serve me or take care of me, because I was afraid I would then feel obligated and have a bigger burden put on me. Do you relate to any of this? That's the person I was. And it literally took death for me to realize that, oh my God, that is how downtrodden I made myself. That's how I treated myself. And I didn't deserve it. I am worthy of being treated better. And I need to be the one who loves myself, because my life depends on it. It really does. And so I realized, though, that the environment I was in was an environment that I had accumulated or created as that person that I was before. I had this victim mentality where I had always been bullied as a child. And yes, I love this from Françoise Ariel. When you choose love, love chooses you. Yes. When you love yourself, you teach people how to treat you. The people around you that you attract love you. People love you as much as you love yourself. And so this is why it's really important for you to love yourself. People love you as much as you love yourself. And what ends up happening, though, is the ones that maybe were only around you because you were a people pleaser, because you were a doormat, the ones that were only around you for those reasons, they may fall away when you start loving yourself. But here's a mistake that many of us make. When they start to fall away, we start to get fearful. We go, oh my God, I'm losing my friends. And we start to go back to being the doormat and the people pleaser to win those people back. We start becoming afraid. We go, oh my God, am I being too selfish? And that's the thing. The way to get cancer out of your consciousness is to actually not even worry about whether you're being selfish. Because people who are doormats, people who are empaths, people who think too much about other people, your sensitivity towards being selfish, that line is way too low. You actually believe that when you are taking care of yourself for your own survival, you are being selfish. And perhaps at some point in your past, this was a survival mechanism and you had to be this way because of your family, because you were rewarded when you gave of yourself, when you pleased other people, when you were non-confrontational, when you made yourself small, when you made yourself invisible. Maybe you were rewarded back then for doing that. And so as a survival mechanism, you developed that. But as an adult, as you go through life, it doesn't serve you anymore. It really doesn't. So what I want to tell so many of you who are dealing with illnesses, because here's the other thing I have noticed. People who are doormats, people pleasers, people who allow themselves to get drained, who put others before them at all costs, you're also the people who seem to be the most susceptible to getting illness. And I really have noticed that. It's not a scientific fact, but I have noticed that from people who write to me and talk to me, and in the few years that I've been doing this. So keep that in mind. Keep that in mind. And keep that in mind that you are the people that need to hear that your baseline for what's selfish is too low. You need to start taking care of yourself. And not only that, you need to start living life and living life with passion and finding your passion and finding your will to live. The biggest determining factor of your health is your passion for life. It's not what you eat. It's not following some diet from other far off land. It's about your passion for life, your reason for living, your desire to live. That has to outweigh all the problems and the weights and the fears that you have for life. I hope that what I said makes sense to you and that you resonate with you. I'd love to hear from you. And if there are some burning questions, I would love to go into the questions if there are any burning questions. And Danny's been popping up some comments on the screen for me, and I so appreciate all your positive comments. Thank you. One person asked if this video will be on replay for later. Yes, it absolutely will be. It will also be posted to YouTube. If you loved this video, I have a lot more like it on my YouTube channel. I will post a link to my YouTube channel on this thread. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel if you like this video, or even subscribe to my newsletter because I do send them out in my newsletter. And there's a question from McKay Dolan. I have a question. I've been reading about law of attraction, quantum physics, and it all points to the belief that whatever you desire has already happened. What are your thoughts on this? Yes, although I think of it slightly differently, and different people have different ways of expressing it, I can see how that could be true, that whatever you desire has already happened. The way I articulate it, and it could come to exactly the same thing as what you have said, is that if you have a desire for something, a burning desire for something, it means that that is your calling. That is the calling that you came into this world with. So don't suppress that desire, because your calling or your desire, your calling, your imagination, all these things are your channel to your higher self. Your higher self is that self which is your permanent self, your soul, your spirit that set you forth in this life. And your calling, the reason why I believe it's called a calling, is because it's calling you to your future self. This is what you desired to come here to manifest. Your imagination is your clue. Whatever your imagination tells you is your clue as to what you came here to manifest. Your calling is calling you to your future self, where you have already manifested that. So don't suppress it. Many of us have somehow been conditioned to believe that if we follow our desire and we follow our calling, we are actually being selfish. No, what you're actually doing when you suppress your imagination, when you suppress your desires, when you suppress your calling, you are actually suppressing that which you came here to be and do. So yes, absolutely, McKay. Thank you for that question, because it allowed me to express this, which I'm sure helped a few people. Michelle Lerner Myers, do you know of any oncologists who embrace the understanding about cancer and our consciousness? I am certain there are. I have come across some. I'm going to share a little story with you. We need brave oncologists who are willing to break out of the medical paradigm. So, what happened is, when this happened to me in the hospital, I was being treated by an oncologist. I did have chemotherapy, but the oncologist that was treating me knew it was not the chemo that healed me, because I was at end stage to the point where nothing could save me. And any more chemo at that point would actually have taken me over the brink and killed me. That was the point my physical body was at. When I healed, I was not expected to come out of the coma. My organs were not expected to start functioning again. My oncologist did not know what to write in my medical records, because he did not know how to explain it. So when I told him what happened, he completely believed me. But here's the thing, when my story actually started to spread on the internet, my oncologist was interviewed by a newspaper, because the newspaper asked me what happened. I told them what happened. They said, can we interview your oncologist? Would he agree? I said, yes, he knows what happened. He agreed. I had a talk with him, and even he knew that that he didn't understand what happened to me. He had said it in his own words, and he said, I completely believe you, because you're not the first person to tell me that they've had a near-death experience. So when the press interviewed my oncologist, though, he denied it. He actually said she had a remarkable healing, but it was the chemo that healed her. Now, here's the thing. He was afraid of being called a quack. And I realized that later. I was so hurt that he threw me under the bus on that press interview. But subsequently what happened is that my my family doctor, Brian, stepped up and said there is no way that the chemo could have healed her. Because he was with me through my whole journey, and he was my family practitioner, my MD or GM, GP. So he actually stepped up and said, and even said it in an interview, there is no way. There was no way, and she was past that, she was at the point where the chemo would have killed her. And another doctor, Peter Koh, stepped in, who is an oncologist, who researched my case and also confirmed that it wasn't the it wasn't the chemo. But Peter Koh also said to me that you will be hard-pressed to find oncologists who will say this. And Peter is a retired oncologist. He said, I have nothing to lose. I can say this. But your oncologist who treated you was at the prime of his career. He doesn't want to risk being called a quack. So oncologists know it. They know that cancer, that medicine is not an exact science. But the problem is, the minute they start talking in this way, they get accused of peddling snake oil, and they get accused of being called a quack. So there's my little story. Thank you, Ida Cedric. I am an oncologist, and that is true. Thank you for that. Yes. So we need oncologists. So I am willing to speak up and say it because it happened to me, and I have nothing to lose. You can call me a quack. I'm not selling anything. I have no agenda. So call me what you want, because I don't care if you don't spend any money and don't buy anything from me, because I have no meds to sell, nothing, even if you don't buy my books or whatever. I am sharing it because it's the truth. But what we need is for people in medicine, people in oncology, to step up and really speak the truth of the radical remissions that they're seeing. People like Kelly Turner, she writes about this kind of thing. She's fabulous. So yes, yeah, so we are changing slowly. When I started sharing my story 12 years ago, when it happened, it was much harder. The audience was much tougher. I was challenged, and so I stopped sharing. I stopped sharing because I didn't want to get my oncologist in trouble. And people call, and if my oncologist defended me, he would have been called a quack and a snake oil peddler. But it's definitely getting better today. Paramjeet Tovi, question. When you were in the other realm, could other spirits, essences see everything all the time? Seems spooky. But yes, they could. Yes, they absolutely could. The essences in that realm, the spirits, are deceased loved ones that are still there. And they're always there. They're always around us, but they're also incarnate as other beings. But the essence, when you are without your body, when you're in that realm, you can see all of time all at once, and you can see all of space, and they can all see it. But all they feel is unconditional love. They feel unconditional love for you, and they will never use anything to your detriment. Never. It's just, that is a physical thing. What we tend to do is we tend to project our human understanding on to God and discarnate beings. We tend to project human emotions and human envy and revenge, and we're afraid when somebody dies who was our enemy, they're going to take revenge on us. No, when they are without their physical body and their culture and their beliefs and their layers, they have a different understanding, and they understand why they did what they did, but they also understand why you are the way you are, and they're much more compassionate and empathetic when they're without their bodies. So don't ever worry about that. Margarita Olive, how does one differentiate true calling from a conditioned desire that comes from wanting to be someone that you are not? Is the way that your heart feels, and can the true calling be shut by fear? Okay, so true calling always feels exciting. It can make you feel anxious in a good way, like excited. Like, you know how when you were a kid and you were really, really looking forward to going to the beach or that holiday, and you had these butterflies in your stomach of a good anxious. True calling feels like that. True calling is also, Your imagination unravels your true calling. True calling feels passionate. It feels good. But things that are not true, things that are conditioned, you know, some conditioning is good. It helps you to develop good habits. But when something feels fearful, then that means it's not serving you. Then it's not your true calling. If it feels fearful, it is not guidance. Because even guidance that is there to help you, even if it's supposed to take you, even guidance that is there to warn you of danger does not come in a fearful way. It comes in a way that feels safe. It's like, oh, I am being guided to get out of this because it's dangerous, but I feel really safe going in this direction. It's not like a, oh my God, if you do this, you're going to get killed and run over. It's not a fear-based guidance. Guidance is always love-based, and anything fear-based is your mind. It's your mind that is creating stories because you have a belief that we live in a dangerous world. Actually, we don't. We actually live in a safe world, but the bad stories, the dangerous stories, are the ones that get perpetuated faster, much faster, and they get spread faster. And the more we fear, the more we enter into fear-based situations. So we're perpetuating fear faster than we're perpetuating passion. But in actuality, we could change it just like that by perpetuating passion. So, Candy Brandt, are you supposed to feel pain to heal? You can. It can go either way. Pain is not necessarily a bad thing. It's the fear of pain that kind of can take us down this down a spiral. But for many people, the fear is worse than the physical pain. If you are told that this physical pain is good, for example, when you work out and you're told that this is a really good pain, it's your muscles getting stronger and you're burning off fat, then the pain doesn't feel scary. It's the fear of the pain. So if you were to change it in your own mind, because we have been, again, conditioned to believe that pain is bad. But imagine if you told yourself, oh, pain is a good thing. When I feel pain, it means I'm growing in some way, or my body is telling me something. It's communicating with me. What's my body trying to say? You can actually talk to your body. Close your eyes, go into meditation, go lie down and say, what is my body telling me? And listen to it. Or go see a healer, a professional who'll help you talk to your body with muscle testing or something like that. So there are ways to communicate with your pain. But when you fear your pain, you start to compound it now with the fear. When you feel fear, don't fear the fear. Don't say, oh my God, Anita said don't feel fear. Now I feel fear, so I'm fearing the fear. No, accept that. Oh, I'm feeling fear as well. Allow the fear and allow it to pass. Don't judge the fear. Don't judge anything. Don't even judge yourself being judgmental and judging. Just let it all pass and say, okay, what's judgment is there? Okay, allow it to be there, embrace it, let it pass. Allow the fear to be there, and if you allow it, embrace it, it will pass. You can even ask it, okay, fear, what are you trying to tell me? No, you don't threaten me, it will pass. The pain, you can ask it, what is it there for? But remember, the way sometimes to mitigate the fear is to say, oh, what if this pain is nothing for me to be fearful for? What if this pain is not that, oh my God, you have cancer again? No, what if the pain is my friend? Because my body is my friend, my body loves me. So what is the pain trying to tell me? What's the message? And it's trying to convey a loving message. So if we send ourselves these kinds of messages, they are so much more loving. That is how you love yourself. You love yourself by telling you, my body is helping me. My body is my friend. The pain is telling me something loving. It's not something bad. Everything that happens is here to help me. Everything is a growth. what I feel that every single thing in life is a learning experience. But having said that, I don't go digging around looking for the lesson, because another thing that we do, everything has a shadow side. Another thing we do is we go, everything has a lesson. So now let me work out what's the lesson in this so I can get rid of it. And then we spend our time digging around looking for the lesson. Don't bother to do that. All you have to do is focus on, who am I if I didn't have to go through this? Who am I without the pain? Who am I without the disease? Who am I without the illness? Who am I as a healthy person? And focus on that. And the lesson will come to you. You'll realize that every pain you've had, every bad experience you've had, has been a learning experience. You don't have to go looking for the lesson. I'm going to read out a few of the comments before I finish off. Rosanna Herring, thank you. I'm so happy to catch you by chance. Thank you so much, Rosanna. And also, I want to tell you all, this video and many others like this are on my YouTube channel. And I also want to tell you that one other thing I love to do is I love to do events. I have many events lined up where I get invited to speak by people. So I would love for you to check out the upcoming events I have, because I always love to say hello to you in person. I love to see in person who are the people who are tuning into my work, who are the people that are reading my books, who's read Dying to Be Me. I'd love to meet you guys in person. I am excited that for the first time this coming weekend, I will be going to New Mexico, to Santa Fe, New Mexico. I've never been there. So honored that I'm speaking at an event that I've been invited to with Greg Braden, Bruce Lipton, Eben Alexander, Lynn Twist. I mean, such visionaries. And it makes me so happy that I'm going to be connecting with them, my tribe. If you get a chance, I'll post the link for the event in this thread. I'm sorry it's such short notice, because it's just that it happened all of a sudden where I was invited to come and join the team with my wonderful brothers and sisters. So please check out that event in Santa Fe, New Mexico. Bridget Elsbeth Larson, love your saying. Hi from Denmark. Thank you, Bridget, for tuning in, and thank you everyone else. I'm also planning more retreats for next year, for 2019. And the reason I'm planning more retreats, these are 5-day, 7-day retreats. I'm doing a cruise as well as some retreats at Omega and 1440 in Santa Cruz, 5-day, 7-day retreats, because I like to take people out of their environment, because you've been conditioned by your environment. And when you go to an event, a keynote speech, or when you watch a YouTube video, we then have to go back to our old environment. I'd love to be with you for a full 5 or 7 days so that you can really align with who your authentic self is and get in line with, excuse me, with your true purpose. And so that you can also really know what your body is capable of doing without naysayers or anyone to tell you that you're delusional or anything like that. Because when you really are surrounded with people who know and believe that your body is capable of doing so much more, it changes it for you. It really does. And when you're in an environment where that is what your belief, it's like what I was saying about the people in Okinawa. They're not pulling a diet out and taking it into their environment. Their environment is conducive to them living these long lives. This is what I'm trying to create. And this is what I've planned for 2019. I'm gonna share a link. Amy Wolf is asking, how do I sign up for a retreat? I'm gonna share a link to all my retreats. I would love for you to join me. And please continue to write to me, continue to share your questions, because your questions is what inspires me for these video topics. Thank you all so much. I know I'm going to see you all someday soon, maybe at a Celebrate Your Life event, which I always love to do, and coming up in Arizona in November. Thank you all so very much. And even if you can't come to an event, don't worry. Keep tuning into my videos for as long as I can do this, as long as I can speak, as long as I'm alive. I will continue to communicate with you and share my message, because that's my purpose. That's my calling. That's why I'm here. Thank you, guys. Love you all. And I'll see you all next week, if not before then. Bye.